over my dead body. I'll kill you. Then I'll kill the kids. I'll burn the fucking house to the ground. Then I'll do myself. Brother can't even try that shit. Sister be like, nigga, I'm leaving you. I'ma kill you. You killing who? Let the killing begin, motherfucker. Oh, nigga, let's get some killing going. Oh, nigga, what, motherfucker? What? Nigga be like, I'm just playing, girl. I'm just playing. You know I'm joking with you, girl. You know I'm joking with you. You know I'm joking with you. We don't even get to the part of burning the house down, the kids.
Shalom. Barakatai Yahawa, Barakatai Yahushai. Barakatai Yahawa, Barakatai Yahushai. Barakatai Yahawa, Barakatai Yahushai. Barakatai Yahawa, Barakatai Yahushai. Before I get into this, I pray the Lord to just show me mercy and let my mouth speak only truth. And I pray, Lord, that you reach people who truly love you and who are of the elect. Romans 9:1. I say the truth in Yahawashai, I lie not. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit. Bless our brother Paul, because he has stated so many truths that completed all of the Gospels, just letting us know how to function in these end times. And all the Bible shows us how to function in these end times, but Paul's epistles came from a place of him just being in the world, being on the other side, seeing both sides. And this testimony today is, I'm nothing, I don't claim to be like my brother Paul. I love him and may the Lord bless him, and he lives, because he said to live is Yahawashai, to die is gain. So I'm not saying I'm like him, but I've been on both sides. I've been in IUIC. I know IUIC. I followed IUIC religiously. I did not know at the time that they are a government agency, but it makes sense now. I knew that they were doing Catholic practices because I was Catholic, and I was a devout Catholic coming from from generations of Latino Catholics, like knowing Latin, knowing the prayers in Latin, that deep of Catholic. And they were doing Catholic things. So I was excited to be in the truth. I was excited to find out who I am. And what is it? I was excited to be in the truth. I was excited to find out who I am. But then I realized some very wicked things were going on. First and foremost, I was married. And right away, when IUIC, they arranged us, we had to meet with them. We had to have a council. I begged my husband at the time to go. He indulged because he figured, you know, it was just a phase for me. He's very Catholic to this day. We're no longer together. He decided he didn't want to be in the truth. So, but he stood by me, I will say that, during these times with IUIC. So I have a witness in him and in others, not just him. So anyway, sorry, I digress. They told me immediately after the meeting that basically, they kept contacting me. I was always learning. We all had to send our address, our emails to them, so they could get our IP address, and so they could gain access to our email accounts. Now I know this. I even think I'm not mistaken, we had to email, we had to choose our password through the email or something like that. It was just a strange dance, but I was fine with it because I trusted them and I was following. I'm going to make this brief. This will be my third time recording it because I don't want to make it too long. I just want to get the facts out to the brothers and sisters who are in IUIC or are thinking about going in IUIC. Please hear the Lord's words. This isn't even my words. I'm telling you, they are agents. They are government. That's why you have to wear fringes. There's over 600 laws. They really make you wear fringes. It's so that you can be picked out easily. Because it's just like Jamestown. It's just like Guyana, Jamestown with Jim Jones. It's just like Waco, Koresh. It's the same thing. The government sets you up to be in an organization that strips you of your individualism. You're not an individual in IUIC. You're policed. They watch you. I'm kind of bouncing, but I need to get these points out. They told me I had to get divorced, pretty much, because he wasn't doing it. They tried to make me do another counsel with him, or else I'd have to divorce him. In a nutshell, I'll get into details later if I have to, but that's what happened. That was coming down from the head of these people that were organizing it, which was Gedaliah. I think his name is Gedaliah. He's a shorter stature man. He's Ephraim. And he is also the one who makes the people give money. Like, he pressures the congregation to give money. And I'm talking about four digits, thousands, okay? Not just a couple, 20 or 50 or 100. And within a matter of months, we had to give that. So he was also the one telling the leaders, the men that were leading me, to have me get divorced and marry. What they said is, I have to be equally yoked. I wanted to go to the Passover. Going to the Passover is a huge deal with IUIC. It's like, if you don't go to the Passover, you're an outcast. I was told that I could not go to the Passover with my husband at the time because we were not equally yoked. They will say that they teach the unbelieving wife saves the unbelieving husband. They're liars. Behind closed doors, that's not what they teach. In front of people, that's what they say. Behind closed doors, they told us not to go on YouTube, that if we went on YouTube, that they were looking at all of us. They know when we're on there. They know what we look at. At the time, we didn't believe it. And also, I didn't know anything about any other camps. All I wanted was the truth, and I thought I was getting it. So then I start hearing about this group, just from them, out of the blue. GMS, these rapists, they're monsters. Be careful of them. And they want to rape you, and they want to rape your little girls. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's horrible. And you sisters know that's what they teach, sisters and brothers, but you sisters probably have had that reaction. So then I was like, wow, thank you, brothers. I'll steer clear of this GMS kukui. Like, oh my goodness, you know? And so they're still trying to pressure me to get divorced. And also they're telling me, why aren't you changing your name? Why haven't you changed your name? Why haven't you changed your name? Did you choose your Hebrew name yet? Did you choose your Hebrew name yet? And we had to send our government names to them and other information. Our social was included. They said that so they could help us change our name. Now I know it's just because they're a government agency to get files on us. So, you know, you hear, stay off YouTube. And then I started watching these other videos. I didn't know it was GMS at the time. But I did hear, you know, the name. Yahawah Bahashem Yoshai. I kept hearing that. So I was still searching for the name, even though I was following IUIC. I was like, I know his name isn't Jesus, but okay, I'm still gonna, you know, go ahead and keep on looking for the name. So I was using like Yeshua, and I was just searching all over YouTube and still following. Then I noticed some things in the interim, like little things that were happening that were like kind of, they were bringing my spirit down. I was losing fire for IUIC, but I always see, this will touch home for a lot of people that are listening to this, like they only keep the deacons and captains in direct contact with you, in communication with you, and Nate Daniel and Kanai are like off limits. So that's just a tactic to keep you from leaving and for keeping you in love with the leaders that back then they were elders. And I really always would say, I know the elder doesn't know this is happening. So that would keep me going. And if any of you felt this way too, I always was like, Nate Daniel was like, he reminded me of Denzel Washington, how he acted and how he would smile really big. Not his looks, but just how he acted. And I always thought, is he an actor? In the back of my mind, that was the Holy Spirit. I was like, is he an actor? Wow, was he an actor before? But I was very devout, very dedicated. I mean, it was hard. Even after I left, I still was calling him elder. I still had like this love for him as an elder, because he's the one who showed me the truth. Again, back then I didn't know that they were actually a government organization. Ithon and Asaph were the ones that said they were the ones that said, we know, because I started to watch other just videos. They told us, quote, stay off of YouTube. You are not to be on YouTube. You are forbidden to be on YouTube. We know which one of you are on YouTube. We know what you're doing. We know when you're on there. We know how long you're in there. We know exactly what you're watching. We can see. That is what they told us. And you all know that we're listening. You brothers and sisters know that that's true. Anyone who is there now that doesn't know this, well, it's true. What are you going to do with the truth? Are you going to hear or forbear? I have nothing to gain. I do want people to know this, though. And I have never come out like this publicly. I've shared my information, my story with many people, but I've never done this. And I think it's time to tell people, because we're at the end and these people are just trying to get you all gathered up to just pretty much get you on the red, blue, or yellow list. It's up to you. IUIC are government agents, officials working for the government. They are. I'm not going to get too deep in that right now, but I'm not just saying that because I'm a parrot. I know. For someone to be able to go into your email, have access to your emails, be able to see whenever you are on YouTube, be able to see when a video that is counter IUIC goes up on YouTube, and to quickly go and jump on the comment boards and thumb it down. That's not just a coincidence or light thing. That's an organization. But Ithon is the one who primarily, he's the one who works on YouTube. He is the one, he's analyzer, and he's also Dragon Slayer 1611. He is many other aliases. And I know it's him, because I used to follow him so religiously. He told us that the Messiah is going to come out of the ocean, by the way. You brothers and sisters that were in that class, you know he said that the chariots are like the kaiju on Pacific Rim, and Yahushua, he didn't say Yahushua, he said Christ will come out of the ocean. He also told us that he has many books on witchcraft, and that he recommends that we do not try to get books on witchcraft, but because we can't handle the power, but he has them. You that were in the class, you know it's true. I'm sorry if I'm just bouncing. I just want to get this out to you people that are in IUIC. They told me that I couldn't go to the Passover because my husband wasn't in the truth. They told me that to try to convince me to leave him and go to the Passover with just my children. They told me that if I try to do Passover at home with him there, that I'll be sinning against the Most High. A woman came out in the congregation in a, I think it was a Sabbath class, and she said how her husband was having sex with her 15 or 16 year old daughter. She, like a lot of us, had taken it to deacons and captains who just were ignoring her. So she thought, oh, if I could just get it to the elder, he'll know, because I know, like we used to all think, the elder doesn't know. So she took it to Nathaniel, and he was acting so shocked and devastated, and he may have been, because I've seen him look sad when they're doing wickedness, but he still goes along with it, and he's still a part of it. He's leading it. He knows that he's decided to go against the Lord. This isn't a light thing for me to say. I was dedicated to that group, and I believed that man was sent by the Lord. All are sent by the Lord, left and right side, but I thought he was righteous. So anyway, he said, sister, don't, she said, I'm taking it to the authorities if nothing's gonna be done. He said, sister, don't do that. You'll devastate us. You'll ruin the church. You know, think of the church and we'll do something about it. I found out later that from a brother who went on later to do a testimony on YouTube, but of course it's been taken down because IUIC controls anything that comes out from the Hebrew Israelite community, anything. And I mean, when they control it, I don't mean they have so much power over the Lord's word. They can't control the Lord's truth, but they control the actual videos. They work with Google. They're the ones that police YouTube, and they're the ones that do all this scoffing and organize it and recruit. They recently took a brother's information, a brother who's an upstanding citizen, and this is to you, appealing to you people in IUIC who claim to be such upstanding citizens. IUIC, yes, Ithon and other people have taken the brother's information and used it to scoff. They have exposed not only his business, putting not only him in danger, but everyone that works there. Innocent, so-called innocent people that aren't in GMS. YouTube is worldwide. Everyone has access, and they have put people in jeopardy, and they even did mind subliminal messaging, like who wants to blow up the brother's building, the brother's building. Why, please tell me why everyone sees that there is MK Ultra, why everyone sees that there is subliminal messaging in advertising, and in how everyone sees there's a cult. Everyone knows it's there. Everyone knows it. But when you say it's right here, people go, okay, conspiracy theorist. No, it's not a conspiracy theory. It's true. See, I was in IUIC, and I would go and watch videos, and then the next day, they'd tell me what I watched, basically. One day, I had watched a video, and then I talked on the phone to someone about a video. It had nothing to do with the truth. It was about someone I knew before being murdered. And I talked to a couple people about it, like, wow, look what happened, to this person. And IUIC had done a news article on this exact story that I had talked about and that I watched on YouTube. Because at this point, they were sick of me because I was asking questions about the name and the chip. And ASAP told us, when I asked about the chip again, he's like, look, you sit in front of YouTube when you're watching YouTube. If you don't, I'll be the first to get the chip. And if you don't want to get the chip, they're going to come and get you anyway and forcefully put the chip in you and set you right back in front of those YouTube videos you're watching. So fast forwarding to the end, after the woman with the baby, I mean with the Salakian, with the daughter being raped by her husband and nobody doing anything about that. I don't know if I mentioned this, but Yawasop said to, he suggested to the molester, the child molester, because even though she was 15, it was his child, hence he's a child molester. Yawasop suggested that the man should go have a brother that she was friendly with, get her drunk, and then have them make love, and then say the woman was, you know, blackmail her for being an adulteress. So Yawasop, that's what they do over there at IUIC. That's what they do. They force women to divorce their unbelieving husbands and marry part of the congregation. At the end, the last straw was when Yawasop told me and the rest of the congregation that this is what they teach, that we're going to be taken in the chariots, then we're going to be saved, put in the wilderness. Some of us will still be killed because there's going to be 2/3 amongst the wilderness. This is all getting you ready for the concentration camps, you people that are in IUIC, and the people who need to come out of IUIC, please hear this. They say that the saved of their group will be taken to a wilderness from chariots that will come out of the ocean, and then they will kill people that are not doing the right thing, and if the children of the people ask for birthdays or do anything or ask for Christmas, that they will have to take the children, the parents. One parent will hold the child steady. The other parent will take the sword and run the sword from front to back through the child. And that the savior will be overseeing the actual act of the killing, the murder. They didn't say murder, of the killing, to make sure that it's being done correctly. And this is 100% true. Nate Daniel was going with that. Yawasop was the one doing the description of the murder. You that were in the class know it's true. You know it's true because you heard it. And blood is on your hands if you know you heard it and you're still in IUIC. And that's when I was just, that was the final straw. Everything that had built up from them telling me I couldn't go to the Passover, telling me I had to divorce my husband, telling me that I kept on telling me I had to change my name to a Hebrew name, making sure it's Hebrew, so they can, again, they can mark us. So they can find us when it's time to gather us up. Just like in Germany, when they put the Salakia, when they put the Star of David on the Jews, and I believe that those were real confusion of faces, Jews, foreigners, Israelite foreigners that wore those stars. But anyway, that's another story. What else? Oh, Finally, I asked when they said that thing about us killing our children, because that wasn't the first time they taught a class about how we preparing us to have to kill our children. It's another class when they taught using the scripture and the law about rebellious sons being stoned after you take them to the elders. So they did a whole Sabbath class on that, and they have that. People were there. It's like people know that Nate Daniel taught a class that killing, basically getting people conditioned that killing your children isn't unbelievable. So I finally just, I think I asked, you know, something about the name, because I didn't just ask because I was so angry to hear them. Because Yahusop is, oh, he's so evil. He's just a big, like, he reminds me of, remember Fraggle Rock, the trash heap? He reminds me of the trash heap. Just like a, he just like a heap. He's not even sitting up straight when they teach. He's just like a heap of, like, he's just like a heap of, like, Colt 45 soaked garbage. And he's demonic. But anyway, they were finally, they had, this was, all of this that I told you was over, like, a year and change. This all happened. And I was, like, finally telling, speaking up, saying, well, what about the chip again? I think I asked something like that. And then that's when they just were just fed up. And that's when that one captain, the Gadalia, he said, you know, he starts saying how I'm wicked and how, you know, I am, they're gonna know who I am, but you know, it's the Lord's will, and I just pray the Lord protects me. But they start saying stuff about me and making up lies, and then they told me if I continue to keep asking questions and keep on stirring up the congregation about, you know, the name and the chip, in a nutshell, that they're going to ban me from the online classes. I was like, I don't really care anymore. This is not right. We're not supposed to kill our children for asking for birthdays. And if we're saved, that's what I think I was asking. If we're going to be saved, why are we going to be, why would our kids ask for birthdays? So I left, and once I left, not even a day later, they started coming by my house. They came at night. One time they came and they said that they were tow truck drivers and that I had to come out. It was like 12 o'clock at night that I needed to come out and move my car because they needed to tow a truck, another car. And I knew it was them because by the grace of Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahshai, I saw one of the brothers in the background. I was like, you're with IUIC. And I was like saying that through the door, through the people. They left. Then they came back again, and they just were banging on the door, and they were saying, my estranged ex-husband's name, they were saying, come out, this is the police, we need so-and-so to come out right now, like boom, boom, boom. And I was like, he's not even here, he had already left, he was gone. They knew he was gone, though, because they were surveilling my place, because I would leave the house. And oh, by the way, I said, I know you're not the police, because back then I didn't know they were the police. They are the police. I said, I know you're IUIC, and that's when they left. Then I was so, like, paranoid. I would get in the car, they would follow me, I would see the same people following me in vans and cars. They would take pictures of me. They would, and these weren't just Israelites, these were Edomite looking people, like, that were doing this with them, like them and other people. Then they sent this woman to sit in front of my house. There was a bench in front of my house. It was like for the bus, And she sat there, and I kept seeing her there. It was strange because, you know, the first day I saw her, I was like, I mean, it wouldn't be strange to see someone sitting at the bus, but she would always stare at me when I would, because when I would drive out, she would just look at me, and she had a baby, a very cute baby on her lap. And finally, she kind of flagged me down, and I thought she was going to ask me for a ride. So I asked her, oh, do you need a ride? Because she had a baby, and I had seen her before. And she's like, no, I wanted to talk to you. And then I was like looking at the baby, and something told me this isn't her baby. And I don't think it was her baby, but they had sent her, and she was sitting there, and she didn't have her fringe. She didn't have in her fringes, but she started asking me questions about IUIC, about if I'm a Hebrew Israelite. She didn't say IUIC, and I go and I start saying, you know, yes. How did she know that? You know, and then she started saying stuff, and then finally she started talking about IUIC, and I said, are you an IUIC? And she said, oh, this is what she told me after a while, once I started talking to her, because she opened up, because she was just a woman, and she was brainwashed until I kind of, you know, started telling her stuff, and then she shared some things with me. But at first she's like, well, they brought me from Florida here so I could get married to one of the brothers. And she's like, maybe it was her baby, but something tells me it wasn't. She's like, I said, where's the baby's dad? And she's like, he's in Florida. See? And they made her leave him. She didn't say that at first. And then I was like, well, you're going to marry someone here? And I had already been out of IUIC, and they were stalking me and crazy. Oh, they would call me over and over and over and over and blast the audio Bible, all the stuff on like death and judgment, and they would blast it. And then one of them, I'm not going to say his name because then, you know, it'll speed up their process of trying to come and get me. But one of them was really, really like obsessed with me, and he wouldn't leave me alone. He was kind of weird. And then she told me about that same guy. She was like, he's suspended for, you know, being inappropriate with sisters. Probably because he wasn't smooth with it. Like, you know, he was just like too open with it, and they're smooth with it. So, she seemed scared. And I go, well, why don't you have on fringes? Don't they make you guys wear fringes? I was kind of being cheeky. And she lifted up her dress and showed me her fringes on her slip. I was like, oh my goodness, really? Because I couldn't, like, as a woman, like, you're lifting up your dress to show me your underwear to prove that you have on fringes. Like, I hope she's out of it by now. But she told me, after I started talking to her, I didn't, you know, I was like, I left. I couldn't do it anymore. It was just too much. And I told her about the things they did. And then she's like, well, she's told me they're so mean to me. They brought me out here. They know I don't have a car. They make me catch the bus. They make me stay late. Even though the Sabbath class goes late, I have to catch the bus back. And finally, I made a complaint about it. And they told this one brother to drive me home. But he's so rude. He's so rude to me. He's so mean to me. And he's mean on the whole drive. And he just treats me so badly that I'd rather just catch the bus late at night. But when I want to catch the bus to leave the Sabbath class, they treat me like I'm doing something wrong, because I'm leaving, but I have to catch the bus with my baby. So I'm talking about her because I was asking her, like, did she live around the area? She said no. And I was like, then why are you catching the bus here, right here? And then she just laughed and just looked at me and rolled her eyes. And that was like, to me, like, I was thinking, did they send you here? And I know they were sending her there to trying to, like, I don't know, get me back with IUIC or get me to talk to her. And it ended up that I took her to where she needed to go. And she felt really bad. She felt bad about what they were having her do. Again, she wouldn't say it out of fear that, you know, I'd go back and tell them, but she was just saying, bless you, and just a weird vibe. She was really young, too. I think she was, like, 19. So, anyway, yeah, that's pretty much what was going on. They still, to this day, you know, I know they do things. If, like, I know they're going to try to say something or contact me or find out who I am. But may Yahweh B'Hashem Yahweh Shai have mercy on me. And I'm doing this because, you know, like the little comedy skit, I'm going to put at the first of this, it's not really funny because let the killing begin then. You know, you want to expose people. You want to try to destroy lives. You can't destroy the spirit. The Lord says to fear the one who can kill the body and the soul. The Lord can raise us right back up in the flesh. He controls everything. So this is for Ithon of IUIC. I know and you know that you are controlling YouTube and that you are putting the brother's information, that you put the brother's information out. And in the name of Yahweh B'Hashem Yahweh Shai, the Lord said this, that we must be vigilant and watch your cultism. We must watch how you hide. We must not ignore your symbols in your videos. We must not ignore your occultic ways. We must bring it to the light in the name of Yahweh Shai, in the name of Yahweh B'Hashem Yahweh Shai. And this is something that they ironically like to use at IUIC, John 8:32. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Not the truth of IUIC, the truth with a capital T. This is the truth, brothers and sisters. In the name of Yahweh B'Hashem Yahweh Shai, I pray that you that hear this see the truth. Ask the Lord to let you, beg the Lord to open your eyes. Beg him to take the stone off of your heart that you can see this truth. You can see that no man is perfect, but you can see if you must follow men that tell the truth. If you must follow men that put the name of Yahweh B'Hashem Yahweh Shai first. If you must follow, don't follow for carnal gain because you like the cookouts and the campouts and the, you know, the lies that men have to bow to women and men must, you know, please their wives. We're in captivity. I want what you want, brothers and sisters that are out there that hear me. We're in captivity, but we are free in the spirit. The Lord has put us all in our lot, and we all have a role to play in this movie. Die trying to be one of those heroes and one of the good people in the movie. Die trying. Turn away from IUIC. They don't love you. They want you dead. That's why they make you wear fringes. All of the laws they turn against, and then they stick with fringes. May the Lord be with everyone. I hope that this wasn't too long. Honors to the double honors to the apostles who treat the word of the Lord as it should be treated, putting it first and foremost, and not hiding it from anyone, putting the truth out there. Double honors to you. Bless you. And anyone out there who are the men back from the ancient days, bless you. Bless you. Bless you out there. Bless Paul. Bless Peter. Lord, bless our brothers bless the spirit of Yehovah Shem Yoshai. And I hope this helps. No other camp has taken a brother's personal information and business, his business. I'm not talking about the agent Yaknan, who actually showed Nathaniel's address when he was working as an agent of Satan. No other brother has shown Nathaniel's address. They've blurted out in GMS. I've seen brothers say, I'm not going to show his address. But the only one that did do it was Yaknan. And now he's yoked with IUIC. Yaknan works for IUIC. This isn't some game. I do want to say this, by the way. Do you see how he's only doing exposed videos and saying, we're going to come for you, we're going to come for your we're going to show who you are? This is a clever Jesuit tactic. That is so IUIC, who really is CIA, through YouTube and Google, can lock down YouTube because they can say, oh, there's too much cyberbullying going on. There's too much of, you know, people's personal information being shared. That's why they're doing these exposed videos. Not like this video where I'm exposing the actual agency that's doing it. While I'm trying to help, I'm praying, laugh, scoff. Anyone that comes on here and scoffs is working for the government. Anyone who comes on here and scoffs is working for Satan. That means you're already a demon and you're marked for death, or you're a fool and you're marked for death if you don't repent, meaning marked for death through Yahweh Bashem Yahushai, through the scriptures, not that someone's going to actually come and do something to you as IUIC does to people, like you did with the thug leader, that Gabar, that brought the truth out because you are a rapist and you followed me. You are rapists, you are kidnappers. The reason you rape the women is you know that we're Hebrew women that follow the truth. And it's also a mind control tactic. When a woman gets raped, you keep her. This is how it works. You take her, you rape her, you keep her locked up in a undisclosed location. You keep her there until she develops Stockholm. She loves you and she starts to be with you. She doesn't want to leave you. It's since the beginning of time. You can see it happen with Benjamin. You can see it happen with all throughout time. What was the late girl's name? Polly? No. Oh, the Mormon girl that got kidnapped. Okay. Oh, here it is.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Meredith Vieira. You probably remember the story of Elizabeth Smart, the young girl who was abducted and presumed dead by many before miraculously turning up alive. In a city famous for its Mormon roots, Elizabeth felt sheltered and protected. She had her large family, her faith, and her beloved heart.
Could you ever imagine a scenario where someone would take you from your home?
Oh, no. My biggest nightmare, I don't know if you ever saw the movie The Neverending Story.
Sure.
And her younger sister, Mary Catherine, say it started as a relaxing family evening. As usual, the two sisters climbed into bed together. But a few hours after they fell asleep, around 2 a.m., Elizabeth woke abruptly. Someone was there, in her bedroom.
I had heard a voice, I have a knife at your neck. Don't make a sound. Get up and come with me.
How did you spend your days, Elizabeth?
I can think of three very easy words to describe my days. Boredom, hunger, and rape.
Did you even feel like a person?
No. How could I? I mean, here I was, a 14-year-old girl, ripped from my family, being raped every day, not knowing when I'd be able to eat next, not knowing when I'd be able to drink next. And being chained to a tree, I didn't feel human. But really, there was. And there was intent to do the same thing to my cousin Olivia that had been done to me.
Her cousin had been spared, but the incident made Elizabeth realize her best strategy was to keep quiet. It paid off within a few weeks. One day, her kidnapper suddenly unchained her from the steel shackles.
Why do you think he decided that?
I think he must have felt like because I was going along with him, because I wasn't fighting as much as I used to.
Then, days later, there was another surprise. Mitchell decided to let Elizabeth out of her prison. He took his wives down the mountain into Salt Lake City to look for food and liquor. They stumbled into a house party where someone snapped this photo. Mitchell had disguised the women in headdresses and veils, and nobody had a clue that the girl was actually kidnapped 14-year-old Elizabeth Smart.
It's almost like you're hiding in plain sight.
It was shocking.
But why didn't she scream out and beg for help? It's a question many have asked, and one that never ceases to infuriate Elizabeth.
It is wrong for any person to ever judge someone in any situation saying, well, why didn't you run? Why didn't you scream? Why didn't you try to do something? That is so wrong and frankly offensive to even ask that question.
Why do you say that?
Because you don't know. You weren't there. You don't know what I was going through.
Or tell me what it's like, because people will wonder.
They don't understand. I was under threat of my life. I was under threat of my family's life. And those two threats right there are stronger than chains for me.